strangely, the profile of Marie Thérèse seems to appear a few years before they even met. It's almost like a Picasso, who's known to be the voyeur, is also able to be the clairvoyant. So when he sees her, he's almost seeing an image that has somehow magically already appeared.
He's waiting for her to appear in his life.
Blessing.
Picasso and Marie Thérèse meet?
They met in January, in the winter of 1927. Marie Thérèse was going out shopping to buy a Peter Pan color, and Picasso sees her and he comes right to her and he says, "You have an interesting face. I'd like to do your portrait. I sense that you and I will do great things together." He was 46, she was 17.
And he's working with Marie Thérèse as his muse in all sorts of different media, which are now considered to be his creative peak. Mm-hmm. Why do you think they're so important to Picasso's oeuvre as a series?
Because somehow I think this encounter with Marie Thérèse brings him back to the early period. He says that he's never been as happy as in 1914. Suddenly it's like a new youth.
It's really Picasso as a magician, though, isn't it? He takes Marie Thérèse, mm-hmm. he dismembers her, he puts her back together in all sorts of different ways. Mm-hmm. This plaster bust, which has a garland of plants around the head. It looks like a devotional object from antiquity.
He's also exploring the theme of the painter and the model.
That goes to the core of it. I think that Picasso's oeuvre is in so many ways about the transformative power of the artist to take a human being, a landscape, or a still life, and transform it into something deeply meaningful.
Yes, if one can say that Picasso never wanted to belong to any movement, he definitely belonged to animism in the sense that he's always bringing soul or life to either a human being but also a still life or any elements of nature, just like a tulip or a tomato.
And he's playing God in some sense, isn't he? I mean, when we look at this image, we see that Marie Thérèse is in the form of the plaster bust, but also the still life of the tulips themselves and the fruit in front of the bust. Yeah. We get a clear indication, at least, that we're looking at some sort of cryptogram. These are elements of Marie Thérèse's body too.
Mm-hmm. Yes, very much. And as you know, because he was married when he first met her, she's at the beginning just appearing as a monogram.
And this great suite of pictures, this is really the public unveiling of Marie Thérèse.
In 1932, you can't deny her presence. She's everywhere on the wall.
4 years later, Picasso painted Marie Thérèse in Femme à la Fenêtre. How would you characterize the change in the way that she's represented?
Well, in 1936, he meets Dorama.
The iconography of those two lovers is conflated. I think in the hat and in the hands, we really get a feeling of Dora rather than Marie Thérèse, don't we?
Yes, as you know, Picasso didn't talk so much, but he said, "I say everything in my pictures," and you see that he's kind of torn between two women.
And his work is about his personal life, but it is also deeply engaged with the historical reality. Mm-hmm. And this tremendous work on paper, Le Viol, from the 2nd of May 1940, is executed at a time 8 days before the Nazi invasion.
Yes, Picasso, as any artist, is the witness of his time, so he feels the need to express his reaction.
And it is absolutely, perhaps, an image about political reality, but also about Picasso's personal story with Dora. She's quite clearly recognizable here. And does this say something about their relationship?
Yes, yes. I mean, we know that the first rape is done with Marie Thérèse in 1933. This is more kind of a tortured relationship. I love this incredible hand which is rejecting the head.
So from the invasion of France through to the liberation, Picasso paints this series of tomato plants and somehow they're a deep symbolic resonance for him.
Yes, it's often been said that it reveals the deprivation that people would face at that time and the complexity in which he's using those branches that kind of crossing in terms of pure formal aesthetical research. It's incredible.
These four masterpieces were each very different in character. How would you describe those differences?
You know that Picasso never gave any title to his works. Still Life with Tulip is clearly about love and differently. The one from 1936 is more about awareness, I would say. The rape would be about drama, and the still life might be just an into life.
Was Marie-Thérèse the love of Picasso's life?
Yes, definitely. I think it was a mystical union that was placed under the sign of passion and freedom.